and a very warm hul johar to all. Issues and challenges in 21st century, organized on the occasion of 30th June Hul Divas by the joint collaboration of History Department, Mayurakshi Gramin College, Raneshwar, and the PG Department of Social Sciences, Sidho Kanhu Murmu University, Dumka. Hul every year brings a sense of pride within us. Pride in the bravery of the people of our land, in the unity of the community and solidarity to drive away foreign rule. Pride in the leadership provided by the brave Sidho Murmu and Kanhu Murmu to one of the biggest tribal rebellions of the country and its impact in the policies of the ruler in the form of SPT Act. Hul also gives a chance to stand still and look back and evaluate on how far have we as tribals come forward and how are we to take our step forward. Jharkhand, being the land of tribals and the heartland of many tribal rebellions and movements, from Tilka Manjhi to Birsa Munda, from Chero rebellions to Tana Bhagat movement, from Ul Gulan to Safa Hod movement, is very apt and suitable for looking into the state of tribal development so far. Looking at the idea of tribal development in the colonial era, there wasn't as such any. Although there was protection given to the tribals, but this was the easier route taken to maintain law and order in the region. The colonizers were unable to understand the complex character of the tribal community and failed to come up with a separate development plan suitable to ensure the all-round upliftment of the region and its people. Post-independence, the policy route taken for tribal development was of their integration in the so-called mainstream. But the nature of the development changed from socio-cultural development to infrastructure development of the region, but they are not rooted in the realities of tribal conditions. Tribal population is rotting under poverty, malnutrition, illiteracy, and performing poorly in the human development indexes. 21st century has come up with its own challenges. Rapid industrialization and urbanization has threatened the mere existence of the tribal. Today, they are struggling to save their identity. Modern education has resulted in the loss of traditional knowledge and diluted the culture and tradition of the tribes of Jharkhand. The tribal languages are losing speakers and need preservation. Climate change and global warming have affected the tribals most as their entire livelihood depend on the nature. And most recently, the pandemic, it has hit the tribals hard, mostly those working as migrant worker, they are now struggling to work their both and meet the
introduction, as he is a well recognized figure in his field of our country. And I would like to welcome with warm feeling our invited guest speaker, Dr. Gomati Bhadra, Hembrew, Associate Professor, Department of Sociology, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. I bid a very warm welcome to all the renowned speakers who gave their valuable time for joining us today. We are honored to have you all with us. I welcome our organizing committee chairperson, Dr. A.R. Khan, Principal, M.G. College, Iranistra. The limb of higher education that Dr. Khan has lived by establishing a college in the rural tribal area is unforgettable. Today, due of them is special.
Dr. Singh, you are not audible.
I hope I'm winner. Dr. Singh, University Department of Political Science, it is Dumka. Both of them are energetic and glorious teachers. I would like much for their help in finalizing this webinar. I am pleased to welcome our Harvard True Department of Political Science, ST Mahila College, Dumka. Finally, I welcome all the distinguished members of our organizing committee. Thank you to everyone in anticipation who will make this webinar possible with their opinions and views. I welcome with regards all the participants in the webinar. We are truly delighted with your presence. I wish this webinar enlightens us all the providers with approaches to deal with the problems of tomorrow. Thank you, everyone. Now I request Ms. Mary Margaret Tudu to take over the session and proceed. Madam, please.
Thank you, sir, for your warm welcome. And now, for the inaugural speech, I would like to invite our very own patron, respected Dr. Sona Jariya, means Honorable Vice Chancellor of Sidhu Kanu Murmu University, Dumka. Dr. Means and her vision and dedication towards academic excellence has brought our SKMU in national forefront. She had joined this university last year in the month of June, the month of whole, and brought whole in the senses of the whole of ideas. She has spearheaded a movement of ideas where the academia takes active participation in not only the purely academic activities, but also current socio-cultural issues. She has been catalyst and supporter of tribal development, leading from the front herself. Her initiatives and ambitions for the university and for education as a whole has begun to show results with such huge participation in today's webinar. So to guide us and to share with us a piece of her wisdom, I invite our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Madam. Madam, I welcome you to click for.
Hul Johar to one and all. आप सबों को हमारा हुल जोहार. ये हुल का महीना है, हमें हुल का महीना ऐसे बोलना चाहिए. सो एंड आई एम सो डिलाइटेड दैट विद द इनिशिएटिव ऑफ टू एंड्स, दैट इज रानेश्वर ग्रामीण कॉलेज, नो वी हैव मयूराक्षी ग्रामीण कॉलेज रानेश्वर and the response of the Faculty of Social Sciences at the University of PG departments have jointly worked this out that we are today here, and I can make out from the participants, the number of the participants, as well as from the names of the participants, that it has had a wider reach than SKMU, and therefore in that sense it is, I'm delighted that there has been a whole sort of activity as far as academics and academic inquiries are concerned. When the theme of the webinar, and if it was offline, a seminar or a conference, was so big and, you know, wholesome, and when a college which had risen up to the occasion to organize a webinar on such a topic of depth, I thought it had to be linked to our whole celebration. And because deep down historically and otherwise, I think what we want to deliberate today, which is the historical perspective of tribal development in Jharkhand, issues and challenges in 21st century, would have had things to talk about and lessons and legacy from what happened in 1855 and even before that. Because what crystallized on 30th of June 1855 and went on till January of 1856, that also had a background. And I think such historical perspectives sometimes are very, very helpful. Some, on the other hand, on the contrary, me being a data scientist, I try to look at, you know, what are the variables which actually define an event, or if there are multiple layers to look at, or multiple dimensions to look at the same theme. And if one looks at tribal development from the prism of, or from the perspective of just constitution, then it seems like such a glorious activity, right? From all the articles that are there in the constitution, and they seem to be doing just the right things that needed to be done for a nation to rise up to the occasion, to be able to include and make the society so inclusive, so that there was nothing called periphery and nothing called margins. So as to even say that people from the margins, okay, or the peripheral communities. But then, it's again has an historical background to why society, Indian society, even 70 years after in 1950, when the scheduling of tribals as schedules was specified by Article 342, 70 years even after that, we still have issues which are unresolved. Maybe platinum areas, or I keep saying the corridors of learning, which are universities and departments and research institutions, are not engaging in the right questions. Do we make those questions which are very academic and try to find an academic outcome, so that we have the required number of publications, but our outcome is not speaking to the policies at the implementation level of the policy? Or I have this lack of competence, and I do agree, accept my incompetence in the authority to say so, but maybe because I'm not a trained social scientist, and therefore maybe there are such wide gaps which have caused the chasm to be wider and wider. I mean, with passage of time, 70 saal mein abhi hamare paas wo gaps nahi hone chahiye the implementation ke liye. I've tried to make a note of how many articles have been there towards, you know, which could contribute qualitatively. Forget quantitative. Quality hota to quantity bhi aayi jata. You know, which could have contributed qualitatively towards what is called development, and especially tribal development, because there are so many provisions and clauses. call it, you know, 375, 244, which talks about, you know, fifth schedule and, you know, special provisions and etc. Then again, you know, towards to facilitate for empowerment and, you know, 164 to have welfare departments and etc. Just the right thing has been decided, but we still have a gap between the decision and, you know, it getting implemented with the right spirit. Maybe we lack the spirit. But maybe there are, I mean, our biases, our own hiccups, our own apprehensions, which come on the way of implementation of these articles, which are provisioned in the Constitution of India, which could have led the way not only in our country, but many parts, maybe in the Asian countries, for the marginalized sections in societies in such countries, you know. But then we still, 70 years later, again, in a university, Sidhu Kanhu Murmu University, situated in the six eastern districts of Jharkhand, we are again taking up this topic, which is a kind of academic burden, and also probably a question of a governance question. But I'm happy that such a tough question has been taken up by the Mayurakshi Grameen College, and as well as the faculty of social sciences in SKMU, and with the three very, very renowned persons in our country. I mean, we couldn't have asked for a better panel to be helping us think through this question, which may be coming from the two speakers. I'm very grateful to Professor Kaushal Kumar Sharma, who's agreed to be a resource person, a keynote speaker for this webinar, as well as Dr. Gomati Bodhra. And it's like icing on the cake. I'm so thankful to Professor Jojo from TIS, who's agreed to chair the session. And I'm looking forward to personally being enriched by this webinar. And I really hope a good number of us are going to take down notes, so that probably it's going to help in a lot of people in their, you know, that their own research questions. I'm hoping that there are master's students also sitting here who could be taking up things which can be, you know, we can work towards some kind of internship program, so that we are able to work through some of the most difficult questions. So I myself would like to wait and listen to all these three renowned persons. As I said, we couldn't have had a better panel than this in the entire country to speak to us. And I'm so grateful to all of them for having agreed to spare the time. As I said, I'm not a social scientist, and therefore, from the computational science point of view, I'm looking for ways to look at, you know, how the patterns of certain things, as Dr. Mary said in the beginning, some of these provisions have only boomeranged or backfired, and because the ground reality 70 years down doesn't seem to have changed, or even if there is a change, like a couple of us have reached the, again, corridors of universities such as TIS or Jamia Millia Islamia or JNU, or even take on the responsibility as vice chancellor of a university in this place. But there is a long way to go, and we would have a lot of buts and the fill in the blanks. And I hope each generation and after each 5 years, people will try to reset their goals as to what they would like to see happen in their lifetime. And so with these words, I'm so happy to see Professor Kaushal Kumar Sharma now. Thank you for, you were able to join. Yeah, you see, all of the three of you are so popular that you were unable to enter because you were delayed a bit. So I'm along with the entire group here, all my colleagues in SKMU, I'm looking forward to be enriched by the session that is going to come. And thank you once again, for three of you, for having spared your time, and Hul Johar again.
Thank you, ma'am, for your valuable words. of encouragement and knowledge. And now we are going to start our technical session. Dr. Vipin Jojo will chair this session. So, Dr. Jojo is a professor at the Center of Social Justice and Governance, School of Social Work, Mumbai campus. He is a renowned. We are honored to have him among us once more.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, I extend whole Juhar to one and all on this special occasion. And in this important occasion, this important topic has been kept for discussion. I think it is very much relevant to the occasion. And Professor Sona Jharia Mins, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Sidhu Kanhu University, has laid down the framework or the her initial triggers with her initial remarks that even after 70 years of independence, we are still to resolve many issues and we are struggling with that. I think in that context, we have to look at what is the historical perspective and what is the pattern of development. And I think we are trying to reflect on that, and based on that, we are thinking of see the how do we look forward. But we have wonderful provisions in our constitutions. Be it in terms of schedules, two schedules we have dedicated to tribals, number of articles we have dedicated or which are important for the tribal development. And despite that, I think this matter to discuss on tribal development continues to be on the prominent topic of discussion in every forum. And very important point, I think Professor Sona Jharia has mentioned about the question of governance. And I like the points you mentioned, ma'am, that despite all corridors of development, there is a long way to go. I think that is the punchline. I see that in your initial remark. And from there, we have these two wonderful speakers, Professor Kausal Sharma and Dr. Gomti Bodhra. I think we have two very, very important speakers coming from two different universities of significant and also as a common citizen of this nation. And that gives me a concern to understand them. Now, I speak to, it's a very common concern that also comes across to you. Whenever we talk to people, and when we say this word as tribal, and then it automatically comes to the mind of people that they may be very poor. They live in backward locations. They are uneducated people. They do not have an access to. Therefore, the mindset of the different common viewpoint that is prevailing is of their backwardness, their poverty, their ill health. Saying or frame clearly the native people of this nation. When you say the native people, they have greater share within areas. They have their own viewpoint to look at. They say they are helpless people. They are destitute. They are marginalized communities. They are isolated communities. Now, this is the mindset the government carries with them. And then there is another set of people, those who work in the name of development, it is the non-government organizations. They are grassroots level workers. They will also project the tribal people in that helpless nature, either to the state government or either to the central government. Now, this is a very complex situation. And that is where the mindset is created by the common people, by the central government, or by the state government, that they are helpless, destitute, and then something needs to be done. The question that arises to my mind most of the time is that no one asks them, what is to be done for you? And that is where we were doing was in JNU. What is the demand and the supply side? So the present condition is, what is the demand and supply side of the demands of the people, of the tribal? Therefore, this concept is that no one has a clear-cut understanding on the demand side, but on a supply side, it is always being viewed as the amount of money to be invested. And that is what the government... This is a kind of a setting where the Jharkhand at present used to very well drafted. I have gone through this policy vision document, which is very well drafted, having very clear-cut visions, and it has a very clear-cut implementation strategy right from the top to the bottom level. But what is lacking today is we have not been able to keep a check. And I hope Professor Minj is here. The universities can take up this as a responsibility to see whether this ITDA, when it has been implemented, can we really research on how much benefits have gone to the tribal people under this program? Because it talks about socially, economically, politically, and that is what in geography we study, holistic development. I hope it is a very widely accepted aspect, and the growth of tribal communities. It includes, now what is the important aspect in this development is that each and every point is to be researched upon. It talks about the strengthening the Gram Sabhas. That means the Panchayat Raj institution, the Gram Sabhas need to be strengthened under this vision document. And that is where it is going to create the economic opportunities and livelihood options, which I will be discussing later, what is the frontier areas for research, plus the whole development for a state in national or in a state level department. Now, that is where I said it in the beginning that the state does not have a huge area under agriculture. Therefore, the limitations are of agriculture production. And the malnutrition due to various other reasons. So therefore, we need to safeguard year-round food security. And at the same time, we need to ensure education, health, nutrition, sanitation and critical facilities for the tribal people. Now, this is one concern under the ITDA programs and policy. And at the same time, we need to address the special needs for the people. And what are those special people? And that is what I made a mention to, that the tribal people have been able to keep the culture intact. So please, 4 or 5 words are very, very entrepreneuring in the total development planning. And then one is that the tribal people in Jharkhand has been able to keep the culture intact. They keep the environment intact. They keep the values intact. And they keep the heritage intact. I hope that is the strength of a nation, when the tribal people are able to manage and hold their cultural value ethics. Therefore, we need to, and that has been addressed by ITDA. Please understand. That has been addressed by the ITDA, that we need to restore their identity, existence, and culture under this program. So, by the way, when it includes to see, then we need to have a mechanism of protection of the tribal communities, including women and children, is a focus one. So all what the, looking at this, what can be the challenges, issues and challenges of the present day? Where to really we need to focus on? When you have, say, the state vision, and that was in 1976, and then ITDA after 2000, I hope, we need to gather. It includes both elimination. Now, the state government and the tribal communities need to understand they need to eliminate the persistent and the anthematic deprivation of the prevention of sudden and severe kind of a destitute concept of the mind and a result of economic inequality rather than lack of food supply. Now, the concern is, one, that is the economic inequality among the people in the Jharkhand. There's a clear-cut division with 28% people
terrains altogether. So the basic amenities are completely missing, whether it's safe drinking water, healthcare facilities, education, etc. So the physical isolation is still a problem over here. Culture should have been part of the development discourse, and then only the overall sustainable development can actually take place. What sir has correctly pointed out, there is, even in the development discourse, what generally one hears about is the voice of bureaucrats. The actual Adivasi voice is completely missing there. And again, you see that whole conversation is almost like we versus they. They are the givers and we are on the receiving end, only the receiver. They are the providers and we are the takers. So that type of mindset has to be tackled, has to be combated in the day-to-day life. So that is again very important. Again, the basic point, because I want to take up the issue of development. If one looks at the development discourse in India, it's completely gender blind. Specifically, one looks at the Adivasi society. Empirically, and so many ethnographic studies has also pointed out that the tribal economy, which is forest and farm-based economy, is largely a woman's economy. So the development discourse has completely neglected the gender perspective out here. Women play such a crucial role, because in the Adivasi communities, both a woman's reproductive and productive labor is being highly valued. In the traditional setup, women has a very high role, but now there is a complete decline. built up among the Adivasi communities. But when the modern state, the British state earlier, and then the post-colonial state, they started making inroads and they demanded an individual patta for the land right. That was again a watershed for the Adivasi women. They complete, and again, there was because of this process of so-called development and implementation of these development projects, there was a complete depletion of all these natural resources. So women almost lost that status, because now, like, they are the providers, they have to work, they are the primary breadwinners in our Adivasi society. But now look at their condition. I mean to say, they're completely deprived of any type of knowledge, education, and in skill building, capacity building, nothing is there. And precisely like the situation has gone down when we look at the status of women. So the development discourse has actually not taken that into account. I agree that in the traditional setup also, women doesn't have the decision-making power, specifically in the political realm. They were being excluded from there in the local Gram Sabha or the village panchayat. But again, with the provision of paisa, that can actually be brought in. So when we talk about the development discourse, women actually constitute the margins within the marginal. So their voices is very important. But again, it's very disappointing that the tribal voice itself is not there, and forget about like women's voice. And today, like all the problems which I just mentioned, which are related to the development trajectory in India, like land alienation, dispossession of natural resources, and displacement, and forced migration, etc. These are actually the gender issues. That's why you just look at it. If you go to the tribal area, in the local heart, or even in any market, you see women, like they have tied up their small kids in their back and they are there working. So more and more women are now like coming up and taking jobs, which actually points out that there is a whole process of marginalization and pauperization when it comes to women. So the development discourse has to take this into account. And again, until and unless, because physical isolation is the biggest challenge. So the funds which are coming, yes, the funds are there, which the government is actually putting onto it. It's so-called investment is being done, but it's actually not reaching the common people in the village, because so much of the system inbuilt is as such that until unless the process of inclusion is there, the process of participatory development is there, that process cannot be, that whole goal cannot be achieved of sustainable development. So women today face a whole crisis of livelihood option in their locality. And again, they're being cheated by so many middlemen in the villages. So as I mentioned, that they're like completely denied of any type of skill building, any type of knowledge in the present context. Earlier, they do have group rights, part of the group rights in the natural resources, so they had higher status. But today, that rights, group right has been completely eroded. Even the natural resources are unable to actually provide proper food, nutrition, etc. And again, see that there is a whole process of marginalization, a whole process of pauperization. So there is almost a process of feminization of poverty is going on if one looks at women. So they go for like all type of work, from very low level, dangerous, risky jobs of migrating to urban cities and taking the job of domestic workers. And this whole process, you see that there is this whole problem of human trafficking, which is again associated with that. So again, if one looks at the basic grassroots level, until and unless the local governance is being provided and a politico-administrative unit is being created specifically in the tribal belt, situation specifically attaining development will be very, very difficult. And again, as I mentioned, there should be the state should actually foster cultural integrity also. That is again very crucial. We stress so much importance on tribal language, but if one looks at the actual empirical reality, the high dropout rates and the illiteracy rates of children is all because they, from the very beginning, like they have They are being taught in an alien language. So if the primary level education, it's already there in the educational policy, but again, never been implemented. Implementation is the biggest problem in today's context. And hence, most of the students, they drop out because until and unless they're being educated in the in their own native language, it will be very difficult. Again, our earning opportunities, again, are very, very scarce in the rural area, specifically in the Eastern Belt. So again, women has to migrate. And again, they have to, they are constantly actually negotiating patriarchy, both the internal patriarchy of the Adivasi society and also the external patriarchy of the mainstream society, because they are the breadwinners, they are the providers, but the development schools never take that into account. They, because there is so much of, in the informal sector also, you see that there are so much of wage disparity which exists. Women being paid low, even if they are doing the same job as the men do. So, but they have to provide for their family, for the children. So they, in the development schools, they were being generally looked as a secondary worker, or maybe they're working for their pocket money or something. Their role as a breadwinner has been completely denied in the development discourse. So that has to be bring forth, which is very, very important. And what sir has pointed out of all these six dimensions, again, woman plays a very, very significant role. So until and unless she being included onto it, a very inclusive policy framework has to be taken into account for the Adivasi women, because they have to, most of the women, these are not only working in the forest-based economy and the farm, they are also working in the market, in the sense that they are into sale, purchase, selling off all these minor forest produce and like farm produce. They are the ones, those who are, but again, they lack the marketing knowledge, the control over marketing and the ability. The entrepreneurial skills are completely not there. So they're being cheated all the time. So until unless that aspect of making Adivasi women empowered, I mean to say, development can never be achieved. And in general, in particular, the Adivasi society, and in general, the Indian society, because this is a holistic notion. It's a holistic perspective. And as sir clearly mentioned, that we should not make a distinction between this is center and this is periphery. I mean to say, like, center for whom? That's the question. And periphery from whom? So this is, again, and it's a very valid question on that particular aspect. Again, coming back to the state perspective, looking at the security issue, most of the tribal region today, like, they have, because of the Naxal conflict going on, there is almost, it's like a very difficult zone full of violence and coercion. By the, on the one hand, by the security forces, another by these Naxal outfits. So again, it's the women, those who have to face all these burn. So again, it's again part of the, even in a state like Jharkhand, again, representation of Adivasi politicians is very much there. But in the larger scenario, what happens is that political, very weak political voice is there. So again, it's the same story. Political power, I agree, like, up to some extent is being provided through all this affirmative action. But economic power is completely nil. This type of poverty which people suffer is, again, terrible. So two aspects are there. One is basically like local self-governance bodies have to be taken up, and also fostering cultural integrity by the state. So in these two aspects, it's very crucial. And again, coming to women, and also in general, the tribal population, again, the basic human development indicators are so low. So that, again, I mean to say, when we talk about development, we should actually start from the human development indicators. That what is the literacy rate? What is the malnutrition? What is the BMI index of the people? If one looks at, this is like a chronic situation happening in the tribal Adivasi belt because of this chronic malnutrition which is happening. Very high child mortality rate and all types of, and again, the pandemic situation has aggravated this health crisis altogether. And they also already have an indigenous medicinal system. A knowledge base is there, though it has declined much because the natural resources are already depleted in that way. So they are unable to actually provide the healthcare facility. But again, that is, again, very crucial. But again, the state support is required specifically at the grassroots level. World over, from the sociological perspective, policies, policy framework, laws, even the best type of progressive laws can only be successful if the state strengthen the grassroots level organization. So we need to have more and more strong Gram Sabha, the traditional Para Panchayats, the women's self-help group, the literary societies, on all these, and all these required, like the funds which are flowing, and they should be directed in that direction to strengthen the grassroots organization. What happens that it's the bureaucratic setup, those who decide that we are the ones, we are the givers, so we are going to decide. So until unless the local governance is being strengthened, the actual development can never be attained out here. And again, other aspects like empowerment is only possible when the capacity building, skill building training can be provided to each and every people. And here you see that the tribal people, again, there is a social differentiation also. The poor people, the lower class group, is almost at par with other general poor people also. So altogether, the same type of poverty alleviation program should be properly implemented. Even the corporate sector's social corporate responsibilities should be implemented properly. But from the sociological point of view, it's important that the grassroots level of traditional organizations should be strengthened by using all these funds which are actually flowing. And precisely then only, like, and the tribal voice has to be bring in, the woman's voice again has to be there. This is again very, very significant, because people, the development discourse have never taken into account, like, the women are so crucial for the Adivasi in economy. And today there is absolutely no economic power on behalf of the Adivasi community. So if they are so very poor, how can you expect development? So empowerment is again very important, and strengthening the economic aspect is very important. Entrepreneurial skills have to be provided. Some type of Adivasi Anaj Mandi should be given, specifically women's market. In Northeast, we have mother's market in the Naga belt. So in the same line, in Jharkhand also, like women's Adivasi women market should actually be made in the urban centers that way, where women can actually come and actually sell their produce. Some type of entrepreneurial skills, marketing skills should also be given to them. And this is again very crucial to tackle all sorts of problems which the Adivasi situation contains in today's life. So if one looks at the Adivasi situation, the predicament which the tribal Adivasi are facing, that's actually the national level Indian society problems. Everything is ingrained over there. So we cannot make a distinction between center and so-called periphery. So it's the holistic approach which the development discourse should actually take. So viable political administrative unit has to be created, but it has to be both at the urban level and also mostly so in the rural areas, because again 90% people are living in the rural area. So, and the process of assimilation is also constantly threatening the tribal communities. So until and unless we keep intact and respect the language, religious specificity, the cultural migration cannot be tackled. And cultural migration is again related very much to economic marginalization and overall, like, the development of any given communities. So acknowledgement by the state is important, because the state Adivasi relationship is very, very crucial. At times, the state itself is giving a cold shoulder. Samta judgment, again, is a classic example. So that has to be taken into account. I mean to say, like, responsibility has to come from each and every sector. It's not that only, like, one sector is there. So participatory development can, democracy can be achieved, and the sustainable holistic development can be achieved when the gender aspect perspective, the Adivasi perspective, the Spalkran perspective can actually be part of the development discourse. It's not only the bureaucrats and their voices are present over there. I have almost touched upon everything, and I don't want to repeat actually what Professor Kaushal has so well discussed that way. So my focus was largely on the gender issues, and whether, I mean to say, like, for example, security issues in the Naxal belt, the conflict which is happening there, people think it's not a women's issue, but it's actually a women's issue. The gender aspect is very much there, because they are the ones, those who face the maximum dehumanized form of violence in these areas. So again, until and unless they being empowered through skill building, through education, and because when we look take up the gender perspective, so what happens generally, the focus is always on women. The gender is both for men and women, and patriarchy is not only of one type. Of course, the tribal patriarchy is one type, very subtle form. The mainstream patriarchy is almost a very different type, and the neo patriarchal values are almost completely different. So now women, like, almost combating all these different types of patriarchy in their day-to-day life. So it's a big challenge, and until unless Adivasi woman, who is the core of that particular family, that particular society, that particular Adivasi economy and the community, until unless she is being empowerment, she is being empowered, complete development or the sustainable development can never be achieved. Again, it will be the like same type of process will emerge, where again a status quo will be maintained by one particular section, and another section will be completely deprived of that particular aspect. So in keeping that in mind, because the resistance has went on and on since the since the colonial time, so it's very important to recognize this particular resistance, the restlessness, why we are also again having the same situation. Tribals are like always, the four jungle jameen. So the recognition of their right to land and has to be taken into account, and women's right onto land, specifically maintenance right, also has to be taken up. And specifically, like the asset building, so there is a complete gap if one looks at the Adivasi society and the so-called the mainstream society. The values are altogether very different. So precisely empowering the overall community, specifically at the grassroots level, is very, very crucial. Otherwise, like, the same problem will arise again and again. We'll never get rid of poverty as such, and India will be a poor country. So it has to be tackled at a context which is the worst sufferer, that is the Adivasi context. And there, if one address the question of unemployment, poverty specifically, this is the abject poverty, vicious cycle of poverty which the Adivasis are facing, which is again very, very terrible that way. And other associated problems related to poverty are very much there. So this whole process of dispossession, this inheritance has to be acknowledged, and that has to be addressed in the development discourse. And we have to move out from like the stereotypical notion, as Professor Kaushal has pointed out. Yes, there is almost like a romantic frozen image which has been created till today, that they're living in the forest and they are always singing, dancing, merrymaking, etc. If one looks at the actual empirical reality, ethnographic studies face that they have moved out to cities. Their villages, their land from which they have come, that has been completely taken up by in the name of development. So now there's nothing to look back onto it. During the pandemic time, we have seen during the first wave, large number of migrants, specifically the informal sector working people, those who have returned by walking to their home, and large section of these were actually the poor communities, and Adivasis were very much part of this informal sector. So if they are into the informal sector, state intervention is very important. We shouldn't have that gap of like givers and they are the receivers. We should be inclusive and participatory in every aspect of decision making. Policy making, of course, is there, but most importantly, it's the implementation. And today we are facing that crucial aspect of implementation. Implementation will never be successful until and unless the grassroots organizations can be strengthened in their own way. We have to look at the traditional setup also, coming to the point of education. The traditional Adivasi setup had this institution of youth dormitories which used to impart education. They have completely been declined. If the state funds can be actually directed to revive those youth dormitories and also the Gram Sabha, the problem of illiteracy, high dropout rates, teaching and safeguarding marginalization can be curbed in so many different ways. So that is again very, very crucial if one looks at Employment generation schemes again has to be reacted in that particular way, because even MGNREGA at times fails when we look at the situation at the grassroots level. They are inadequate. Self-help group again becomes inadequate. So with education, skill building, capacity building, if the community itself is being empowered enough to provide for themselves, that could be the best way of development, the holistic development. And it's not like something which is given in the form of tokenism, like in parts and in bits and pieces. It should be a holistic aspect one has to take if one is looking at a community. At the community level, what exactly happens? So at times, like women are, as I mentioned, like I've taken the gender perspective, so women are being left out. And again, at the national level, like Adivasis themselves are left out when it comes to development. In fact, they have to pay the price of development, this coercive development which has actually taken place. So development has to be, I mean to say, the state has actually focused from the very beginning the top-down approach, that you put something on the top and immediately, automatically it's going to trickle down to the bottom. So that top-down approach has to be changed altogether. Now it should be bottom-up approach, like focusing only on the eagle's eye view. We need to have a worm's eye view. What the people at the grassroots level, they think about development. Generally, the preconceived notion, the stereotypical notion is tribals are always anti-development. This is again the biggest challenge which the tribals are facing. They are not anti-development. If one today looks at the hopes and aspiration of people, the Adivasi people, that is like they want health. People in rural areas, in the remote area, women will say that for me, development is healthcare. Development is quality education. People go to school, children go to school, but they hardly know how to write, how to read. Reading, writing skills is nothing there. Teachers are absent. So they also want quality education, just like anybody else, just like me and you, the middle class. So, and also the basic amenities, which is required over there. We always focus on tribal agriculture, like the sustainable mode of their livelihood. But what about the irrigation facilities, which are completely not there? Still, the education is based on like monsoon. And though we have n number of dams over there, so these are the discrepancies which are very much there in the development discourse. If irrigation facilities being provided, again, not provided, I would say let the people in the Gram Sabha, they manage their water bodies through modern means, a fusion of both these. That is going to solve the problem in so many different ways. So again, strengthening the local grassroots organization will only help in implementation. The most progressive forms of provisions which are being made in the constitution, the laws like PESA, fifth schedule, FRA, which we have, can be actually implemented in letter and spirit. So that's basically the plea which is coming from the sociological point of view, that ethnographics, that sir also pointed out, like we need to have more studies, ethnographic narratives of these people, those who have moved out and those who have actually faced the burnt of the so-called development, has to be taken into account. It has to be documented, and it has to be part of the policy framework in the development discourse. And again, the worst part is that if one looks at the amount of coercion and violence people have faced, this is not testimonial or historical, I mean, this is some memory which they have. This is the everyday life which they are facing. It's the day-to-day life. So ethnographic account of these narration which people are facing in the day-to-day life has to be taken into account. At times, what happened in research, women and their voices completely is missing. So again, gender-specific studies has to be conducted, and more research is required in that particular aspect. Yes, if I have more time, Professor Jojo.
Yeah, if you could wind up, then we could have some questions.
Okay, yeah. So basically, like as I pointed out, like two important aspects, the problem which we have already faced, because 90% people living in, they are least urbanized, ruling in the rural areas. So physical isolation is still an issue. So that has to be taken into account, these areas, because unlike the Dalits and the other communities, they are never living, especially in the locality where the other mainstream population is living. So at times it gets severely neglected. So physical isolation is a big challenge. Another is like the economic and cultural marginalization. So these are both interrelated. So the state should foster cultural integrity also. Their specificity related to culture, religion, language has to be acknowledged. It has to be taken into account. It has to be safeguarded in many, many different ways. And then only like the holistic development goals can be achieved, specifically in the context of Adivasi situation. And we have to actually move out of that particular stereotypical notions also. So ethnographic studies are very, very crucial because we are still lamping onto that romantic and frozen image of tribes doing this and doing that and dancing and merrymaking, etc., etc. But they are very much part of, even in a metropolitan city like Delhi and Mumbai, tribals are very much there. They're working as a housemaid in different middle class, upper class household. But their account is never being taken in the development discourse. This is again very crucial. No laws is there, nothing is there in the informal sector. No self-safeguard is provided to them at all, because again the women, it's become, the gender discourse has become gender blind. So the voices, specifically the margins within the marginals, has to be brought in. This is very crucial for the Adivasi society.
Thank you. Very, very important points Dr. Bodra has raised, starting with the whole trajectory of development discourse, which has to come with a tribal perspective. And she ended with the holistic development approach, which has to be very, very much inclusive of women, tribal women in the center, which should have the participatory governance or the grassroots level participation in the planning implementation, and the Adivasi perspective, which has been emphasized by Dr. Bodra. I think there's a lot of important points she has mentioned, but without repeating what she has said, I think I would go inviting some of the comments, observations. I have been reminded by the organizers, I think in the chat box, that time is still 4:45. So about 10 minutes, we could have some comments and observations. So if you could raise your comments and observations and take the name of the speakers to whom you are addressing to, that would be easier for other speakers to respond. Thank you. So open to the floor for your comments. आप लोग हिंदी में भी बात कर सकते हैं, हम लोग हिंदी में बात कर सकते हैं, इंग्लिश में बात कर सकते हैं, जो जिसमें कंफर्टेबल हैं हम लोग.
हेलो,
यस यस
यस, एमजी कॉलेज रानी से सर, इट इज क्वेश्चन आवर सर.
या गो अहेड.
यस सर, मेरा दो सवाल है सर, एक डेवलपमेंट के ऊपर, ट्राइबल डेवलपमेंट के ऊपर.
किसको एड्रेस कर रहे हैं मौजूद जी, किसको एड्रेस कर रहे हैं सबके सवाल, प्रोफेसर शर्मा या डॉक्टर बोधरा को या दोनों को?
कॉमन है सर.
ओके फाइन गो अहेड.
तो एक डेवलपमेंट के ऊपर और दूसरा प्राइमरी एजुकेशन के ऊपर है सर मेरा, जिसपे मेरा लगता है कि इस पे ध्यान देना चाहिए. एक तो है कि जैसे ह्यूमन डेवलपमेंट इंडेक्स से हमें ट्राइबल डेवलपमेंट का अलग से कोई डाटा नहीं मिल पाता, जहां तक मेरा अपना ये है, तो इस पे एक काम होना चाहिए इस तरह का, या हो रहा है कि नहीं, ये जानना चाहते हैं कि अलग से ट्राइबल डेवलपमेंट का कोई इंडेक्स बने. और साथ में जो उसका एक पैमाना होता है सर, उसमें मेरे अपने ख्याल से दो चीज को उस पैमाने में अलग रखना चाहिए, एक मोबाइल और दूसरा मोटरसाइकिल. और दूसरा सवाल सर, हम देखते हैं ये कि प्राइमरी एजुकेशन में नीचे ही के क्लास में जो है ट्राइबल स्टूडेंट कम से कम वो क्रैश हो जाते हैं, क्योंकि वहाँ जो है लैंग्वेज का प्रॉब्लम हो जाता है. बिना ध्यान दिए हुए ऐसे टीचरों को वहाँ बहाल कर दिया जाता है जो उस लैंग्वेज को नहीं जानते हैं. और बच्चों के साथ ये प्रॉब्लम होता है कि वो हिंदी नहीं जानते हैं, छोटे बच्चे खास करके, मैंने जो रीड किया है सर. तो इस पे क्या काम किया जा सकता है
जी? प्रोफेसर शर्मा, डॉक्टर बोधरा, इधर ऑफ यू कैन स्टार्ट.
आई होप इन्होंने एक जो दो ये बड़ी जनरलाइज्ड बात इन्होंने करी है कि भाई ये होना चाहिए, इसमें जब इन्होंने कहा कि ट्राइबल डेवलपमेंट इंडेक्स किया है तो झारखंड ट्राइबल डेवलपमेंट इंडेक्स ऑलरेडी बनाया और वेबसाइट पे चेक कर सकते हैं ये लोग, और ये सब स्टेट्स में अब यूनिफॉर्म कर दिया है कि दे हैव टू फ्रेम ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ द ह्यूमन डेवलपमेंट इंडेक्स के हिसाब से इनको, जहां जहां ट्राइबल पॉपुलेशन ज्यादा है वो ट्राइबल डेवलपमेंट इंडेक्स का काम चल भी रहा हो और हो भी रहा कई स्टेट में हो भी गया, ये देख सकते हैं वेबसाइट पे। एक तो ये बोला, दूसरा प्राइमरी एजुकेशन को लेके, यूनिवर्सल एजुकेशन प्राइमरी होती है लेकिन हाँ जो लैंग्वेज की प्रॉब्लम बोली है, क्योंकि उसमें रहता है ऐसा है कि पाठ्यक्रम अब उसको लोकल लैंग्वेज में अगर वहाँ का पढ़ाया जाता है या किस तरह से पढ़ाया जाता है ये स्टेट इशू है कि इसको हिंदी में पढ़ाना है, लोकल लैंग्वेज में पढ़ाना है, कैसे पढ़ाना है, तो एक यूनिवर्सल प्रोसीजर है कि इसको किस मोड में पढ़ाना पड़ेगा। और हाँ ये मैं जरूर मानता हूँ कि जब बच्चे और टीचर एक्सप्लेन करता हो तो अपनी लोकल लैंग्वेज में जो जरूर करे, मुझे लगता है प्राइमरी स्कूल के टीचर कहीं दूसरी स्टेट से नहीं आते हैं और प्राइमरी स्कूल लगभग लोकल होते हैं, वो जो लोकल लैंग्वेज जानते हैं, ऐसा मेरा मानना है। क्योंकि मैं भी गांव से आता हूं तो मेरे गांव के आसपास के लोग होते हैं वो हिंदी और अपनी लोकल लैंग्वेज आते हैं, कुछ चीज़ें समझा देते हैं। हो सकता है कहीं पर ऐसी प्रॉब्लम आ गई हो जो शहरों से लोग आए हों जिनको लोकल लैंग्वेज ना आती हो, तो सरकारों को ये ध्यान रखना चाहिए, लेकिन ये यूजुअली होता नहीं है ऐसा। लेकिन हाँ ये कहीं समस्या इन्होंने कही है, ठीक होनी चाहिए। और ट्राइबल डेवलपमेंट बहुत बड़ा एक चैलेंज है और बहुत बड़ा आयाम और बहुत बड़ा डोमेन है, और उसके लिए मेरा सोचने का तरीका ज्योग्राफर का अलग है, गोमती मैडम का सोशियोलॉजिकल पॉइंट अलग हो सकता है, टेक्नोक्रेट का अलग हो सकता है, और हिस्ट्री का अलग हो सकता है। हर आदमी अलग अलग से विकास के बारे में सोचता है, लेकिन एक यूनिवर्सल प्लानिंग प्रोसेस जो होते हैं वो सरकारें बनाती हैं और उसी हिसाब से विकास होता है और उसके सब कंपोनेंट आते हैं। इनको एक काम करना चाहिए कि आप ट्राइबल सब डेवलपमेंट प्लान, जो झारखंड का ट्राइबल सब डेवलपमेंट प्लान है ईयर टू ईयर मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ ट्राइबल करती है, उसके अंदर जो है वो वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग, इरीगेशन, लैंड डेवलपमेंट स्कीम्स, एग्रीकल्चर, रेन हेड वाटरिंग, हॉर्टिकल्चर, मल्टी लेयर क्रॉपिंग, डेयरी डेवलपमेंट, पोल्ट्री, गोट, ककून, लैक, आई होप न्यूमरस एंगल्स हैव बीन टेकन अप अंडर द डेवलपमेंट बाय द स्टेट अंडर द ट्राइबल सब डेवलपमेंट प्लान। तो बाकी जो दूसरे डिपार्टमेंट है वो अपना अपना काम करते हैं, लेकिन ट्राइबल फोकस जो प्रोग्राम्स हैं वो ट्राइबल सब डेवलपमेंट प्लान जो है उसके अंदर, और ये 2013 में झारखंड में स्टार्ट हुआ था और अभी तक ये कंटिन्यूस है, और इसमें ये सारे कॉम्पोनेंट को टच अपऑन करते हैं, मुझे लगता है कि वो विकास चलता। अब उसमें मैंने एक ही रेज किया था कि इनकी मॉनिटरिंग, एवेल्युएशन और इम्प्लीमेंटेशन कैसा हो रहा है, ये रिसर्च का काम है, वो चाहे यूनिवर्सिटीज करें, चाहे एनजीओज करें, चाहे कोई भी करे, लेकिन काम जरूर होता है। सरकारें ऐसा नहीं कि काम नहीं करती, करती हैं, कमियां हो सकती हैं, ऊपर नीचे हो सकता है, वो अलग बात है, बट देर इज समथिंग विच इज हैपनिंग। इट मे बी समथिंग हेयर देयर, पोलिटिकल इंस्टेबिलिटी, बहुत सारी चीजें, वो बड़ा कॉम्प्लेक्स इशू, आई नीड नॉट टू डिस्कस इट। और जो गोमती मैडम भी कह रही थी कि ब्यूरोक्रेटिक माइंडसेट अलग है, लोकल कम्युनिटी माइंडसेट अलग है, टीचर का माइंडसेट अलग है, तो मुझे लगता है कि विकास होता है, डेवलपमेंट हो रही है, ऐसा नहीं है नहीं हो रही है, लेकिन हाँ देखरेख करना कम्युनिटी का काम भी है, उसको भी नजर रखनी चाहिए। वी कैनॉट बी इंडिफरेंट टू, बिकॉज दिस इज पब्लिक फंड्स विच आर बीइंग गिवन फॉर डेवलपमेंट, देयरफॉर यू कीप एन आई ऑन इट एंड डू सम गुड रिसर्च एट अ ग्रास रूट लेवल एंड कम अप विद सम फाइंडिंग्स। मेरी तरफ से इतना था, गोमती जी को कुछ कहना है तो।
डॉक्टर गोमती,
नहीं ऐसा कुछ हसन ने पूरा समअप कर दिया, टैकल द क्वेश्चन ऑल टुगेदर। या प्राइमरी एजुकेशन काफी क्रूशियल है क्योंकि बच्चे वहीं पे पिछड़ जाते हैं तो आगे फिर पढ़ाई नहीं कर पाते हैं, जब एजुकेशन नहीं होगा तो फिर वो आगे बढ़ नहीं पाएंगे अपनी जिंदगी में, तो वो काफी क्रूशियल है, क्वालिटी एजुकेशन जरूरी है।
ऑफ राइटिंग्स ऑफ द स्कॉलर्स, I think we will see the shift or the differences of understanding or construction of the notion of tribes. And then we see that how the notion of tribal development has evolved. And if you look at the notion of tribal development immediately after independence, I think the whole the premise was to see that tribes are backward. Tribes are primitive. वो तो जंगली हैं, बोले तो नंगे हैं। जैसे प्रोफेसर शर्मा बोल रहे थे कि ट्राइब्स बोलने से एक नोशन आ जाता है, एक इमेज आता है ट्राइब्स के बारे में। So that's what the stereotype image we have. Even after today, whenever I teach my students, I ask this first question: what do you get in your mind the moment you hear the word tribe. And immediately they live in forest. Okay, so even the people at master level are having this notion that tribes means they live in forest. Okay, they have a dance and song. Okay, they are having their ornament, very, very rich ornaments and song and dance. Okay, so we can see the stereotype even after that at coming at the master level. So that's how the notion has been at this kind of premise. And so what happened our development approach? Immediately after independence, the kind of five-year plans and ITDS schemes which have, the approach of our development for tribal development has three things. What are they? The isolation, assimilation, and integration. The people, we don't assume the tribes are isolated, so they have to be assimilated and integrated. Okay, now we still today, we are seeing that the five criteria which are used for who are scheduled tribes, we all very know, and I think we all will agree that all these criteria are very much contested. One can contest on those things, the primitive, isolated, backward, shy. Okay, these are the criteria we still use. And I do not know whether to call myself, I'm backward and primitive, because I'm a tribe, I belong to Munda tribe. I'm teaching in TISS as a professor, but I'm still primitive, I'm backward. Because that's how the government of India has recognized me as settled tribe. Okay, so that is where the perspective of tribal development comes in. So if we are not able to understand the perspective of the tribal development, that's where Professor Bodhra was referring to, that whole trajectory of development discourse we need to understand. And the tribal perspective needs to be understood. When I say tribal perspective, I refer to three things. The time, place, and the people. Okay, whatever S.C. Roy has written about Birors in 1925, can we say that it is the true even in 2021? It cannot be true. It cannot be the same. Yes. Or whatever L.P. Vidyarthi has written about Ranchi in 1970, about Ranchi, it is not the same situation today. So the context, the perspective evolves from the context. That is the time when we are referring as the basis for defining, and the people whom we are referring, and the place we are referring. And that is why the tribal development cannot be universal. Because we are rich with, we have so much of diversity. Because Jharkhand situation, within the Jharkhand, every district you go, every district village you go, there are differences. So with this kind of diversity, can we have very uniform, straight-jacketed development formula that will fit in everywhere? Probably not. So we have to have that space, maybe basic guidelines and principles we might have to have, but I think each place, each location, each context will have to be different. And each community are different. There are Mundas and Kharias so articulate, but the Birhors, you see, on the other hand, what are the kind of situation? So they are not so articulate and so small, tiny group, just about 17,000 people of Birhors in Jharkhand, I think, if I'm correct. So with this kind of situation, I think the tribal perspective becomes very, very important. That's where what Professor Bodhra was saying, that participation of the communities, which has been ensured by the constitutional provision under PESA or FRA. I think we go by these principles, constitutional principles or other legislations. I think if that can be incorporated and implemented in the grassroots level, I think both the speakers have highlighted that aspect. Now, Ministry of Rural Development is going to commission a national study on devolution of power. So that includes the tribal areas also, PESA area or the fifth schedule area or sixth schedule area. No, when the PESA has not been implemented, what kind of devolution of power in the grassroots level we can think of? Okay, now the devolution of power, this study has been happening. The last study was done by TISS, and this time also they have requested. Let's see if they are asking us to do. I'm very keen to see that when PESA has not been implemented, what kind of devolution of power has been happening in the fifth schedule area? Okay, so this is the kind of situation. And the last point I want to draw, taking things from Professor Sharma about this six dimensions, what he talked about, very, very important. Food and nutrition, economic security, health, education, sociocultural, environmental. I think across the government, interstate governments or bilateral governments or multilateral governments are emphasizing on this aspect, and SDG is the basic document which gives the basic framework. And under these SDGs, I think everybody is talking or putting so much of effort on the biodiversity or the climate change. And how do we maintain the biodiversity? How do we maintain the climate change? How do we take care of the climate change? That's where they are going back to the indigenous community over the globe, all over the world, every country, wherever the indigenous communities are, they are referring, going back to the indigenous communities to learn how they have protected their nature, how they have maintained their biodiversity and their symbiotic relationship between nature and the communities. And that is where now globally, now lots of talk is happening about the indigenous knowledge and the biodiversity and well-being. Okay, I think that is another area of research for us to engage on indigenous knowledge, maintenance of biodiversity and their well-being. But mind you, whenever we talk about research, I remember one of the feminist scholars from New Zealand. I love her argument and writing. She's a feminist scholar and indigenous scholar from New Zealand called Linda Smith. Okay, she writes, the research is the dirtiest word among the indigenous peoples. She writes, research is the dirtiest word among the tribes or indigenous people, because who does research on indigenous people? Mostly non-indigenous people. And the non-indigenous people have their own way of formula or if notion of putting in a bracket about indigenous people. And so they fix the indigenous people are like this. Okay? And then they teach the indigenous people that indigenous people are like this. What a pity, what an irony. And that is why this Linda Smith says, I love her writing. If you could, anyone of you are interested, you can read her book. It is online available, Decolonizing Methodologies. She started her writing as a feminist writer, but later on her writings have been very interesting on indigenous methodology. So the point is, when I say indigenous knowledge, it is the basis to maintain the biodiversity and taking care of food security, taking care of opportunities, taking care of health, education, sociocultural, environmental security. No doubt about that. But we have to see that knowledge, what we are talking about, it has to be looked at from their perspective, from their worldview. And if we start looking at from our angle, then again, that is destroying the whole thing. It is going to destroy the whole thing. And so then we will define that, okay, this is how it has to be done. We will prescribe. We'll prescribe what they should be doing rather than listening to them and jointly what Dr. Bodra was suggesting, that yes, we have to have their voices. We should incorporate their voices, plan together. No? So unless we plan together, unless we hear their voices, I think it is going to be, again, predefined development models. And we will continue discussing like this, and we will not be able to see much change. There have been changes. I think I am one of the products of that change. I can claim that. There have been changes, but that the changes have been satisfactory. As Professor Sharma said, the amount of money which has been spent, why this has been, for so much of money has been spent, but we have not been seeing the satisfactory results. I think critically we have to relook at that, revisit that aspect. I think since I have no time, I would like to stop with saying that this is the time to give spaces for the Adivasi narratives. I think we have to give spaces for their discourse. Their discourse, their narratives have to be in the center of tribal development. I think that will take care of many of the problems, many of the issues what we are deliberating on. Thank you. Over to the organizers.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Juju, for this session. I also thank Dr. Kaushal Sharma sir and Dr. Gomtri Bodhna ma'am. It was very informative and interactive session. The participants are sure to have grasped and gained a lot. Thank you so much. And now I invite Dr. Faiz Khan, the principal of Mayurakshi Gramin College, to give the vote of thanks. Dr. Khan's contribution in the field of education is tremendous. He has very successfully established Mayurakshi Gramin College in Raneshwar, and this institution is running it with great excellence. I welcome Dr. Raish to give the vote of thanks.
Thanks, madam, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I deem it great honor to propose the vote of thanks on this memorable occasion. Let me first start by giving glory to the Almighty God for making today's occasion a resounding success. First and foremost, I thank to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, SKM University, Dumka, Professor Dr. S.J. Minch, who, despite her busy schedule, she found time to provide us her logistic suggestion and guidance in organizing such a great national webinar in collaboration with the Faculty of Science, SKM University, Dumka, really, ma'am, you are great and so kind of you that you have declared the inaugural moment for the next or the forthcoming Hul Divas ceremony. I express my heartfelt gratitude and thanks to Dr. Bipin Jojo, session chairpersons of this webinar. What can I say about his knowledge? He is a store of knowledge. He described and he pointed out all the points described by the speakers and himself so own. And after that, I thank with my gratitude to Professor Kausal Kumar Sharma, keynote speaker of the session, a profound speaker, a profound scholar, and a renowned speaker, JNU Delhi, and Dr. Gomati Bodra Hemram, assistant professor, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi, for their valuable and unforgettable contribution to us by delivering most impressive and interesting lecture concerning the theme of the webinar, Historical Perspective of Tribal Development in Jharkhand, Issues and Challenges in 21st Century. We will remain grateful to you all, sir and madam. I thank our organizing committee members who have spent days together in organizing such a webinar. Especially, I am grateful to Dr. J.K. Shah, the convener, Dean Faculty of the Social Science, and Dr. Sanjeev Sinha, IQSC Coordinator, SKM University, Dumka, co-convener, and Dr. Swarna Kumar Singh, Department of History, MG College, Raneshwar, who worked hard, very sincerely, days together for the purpose. My heartfelt thanks to heads of the departments, faculties, for their valuable contribution, guidance, encouragement in all our efforts. I owe special gratitude to Professor Majid, Department of Geology, MG College, Raneshwar, and his technical teams, Mukesh, Arif, Anup, Prabhat, Dani, and Mohafiz, who worked hard to ensure that this occasion becomes a memorable success. I thank the invitees who have accepted our invitations, particularly those distinguished invitees and the participants, including the students. I thank media members who were with us at this moment for evincing interest, for covering the event, and good hearts who worked behind the screen. Last but not the least, I thank you, my friends, for your cooperation for making this occasion resounding success. Finally, I leave you with an inspiring quote from Martin Luther King. An individual has not started living until he rises above the confines of his individualistic concerns to the broader concerns of all humanity. Once again, I thank you all for your kind attention. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have come to the end of today's webinar. And I would like to ask our Honorable Vice Chancellor for permission to end the webinar.
Yes, we have the permission to end, but I would like to have the last word. That I think much as the theme was so important, we can see that 80% of participants have stuck to the meeting till the very end. And we know we should have apprehended, or rather we should have anticipated that there will be a large number who have been denied admission to the meeting. So next time, whenever we have such a burning topic, we should expand our membership or attendance to the digital platform. And this indicates the hard work that has gone behind. So congratulations to all of you. And as it was being said, this is the beginning of the cool celebration across the university, which we would definitely have, even on 30th, we would have a very interesting and very pertinent webinar. Probably you'll get the link circulated. And we look forward to some spirit of HUL descending on us in order to determine the goals for at least, if not a long time, but at least for 1 year, so that we can make a change that we would like to see. With these words, yes, we have a permission for a formal closure.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. And thank you, everyone.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, you, Professor Sharma, Professor Jojo, and Dr. Bodra. And wish you all the best, Professor Jojo. You become dean from a few days from now of your school.
Tomorrow I have to take the office.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Vipinji. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Professor Sharma. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. It was nice interacting you on webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, madam.
एक बार सब लोग अपने स्क्रीन पर ऑन कर लेते वीडियो पर तो एक फोटो हो जाता.
चलिए मैडम ने छोड़ दी.
चलो. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.